and they're off. Looks like there could be a bit of jostling.
Racing without competition would be boring.
Join Formula One's fastest for rivalry on and off the track.
I get very upset.
There's more to racing than driving at 200 miles an hour. Find out from the experts.
I always get in the car.
The Clive James Formula One Show, Saturday the 8th of March on Central.
Those that can, do, and those that can't, talk about it. Formula One is sensationally exciting, it's colourful, it's noisy, it's got a dash of danger. It's a compelling sport. The talking is over, the action is going to begin, and I can hardly wait.
And I'm already stocking up the fridge. You're with Central, news at 10.
News at 10 with Trevor McDonald.
Bridgewater detective insists I did no wrong. Britain braced for a night of chaos in the gales. Behind the scenes on Britannia's final voyage. And the winners and losers at tonight's Brit Awards. Good evening. A former detective denied today that he fabricated evidence in the Carl Bridgewater murder case. Retired Detective Constable Graham Leake was named in court as one of the officers who faked a confession which led to the wrongful conviction of four men. There have been continuing calls for an independent inquiry into the police investigation. Here's our Home Affairs editor, Jennifer Nadel.
So, Mr. Leake?
Yes.
Detective Constable Graham Leake, now retired and one of the officers at the heart of allegations of misconduct, today refused to discuss the Bridgewater case with ITN.
I've been told not to say anything.
Right.
So, please appreciate the situation.
Later, his solicitor issued a statement denying any improper practice. Meanwhile, Michael Chamberlain, the close friend of another suspected officer, John Perkins, told us that Perkins had talked openly of using violence.
If you were in for, you know, armed robberies and rapes and that sort of thing, you could be sure that you'd have a good hiding. You know, not for the reason because you'd done the crime, but basically to make you put your confession down on paper.
The Chief Constable of the West Midlands admitted interviews at the time of the Bridgewater case could get rough, but said things had changed.
We're talking about events involving a small number of police officers a long, long while ago and has little to do with the sort of service we're providing in the West Midlands today.
Home Office ministers announced moves to allow the videotaping of police interviews, which they said should help in future.
Videotaping can be of benefit to the court. It helps prevent a fuller picture. It protects the rights of the suspect and it protects police officers.
But others, including Dr. Eric Shepherd, who advises the police and warned of fabrication in the Bridgewater case, said videos could be deceptive.
It's based upon a belief that people are good at detecting deception. And in fact, all the research shows that they're no better than the flip of a coin, getting it right or wrong 50% of the time. And very often, they're worse than that. They see deception when there isn't. And what they're really seeing is signs of stress.
Concerns also emerged today about government plans to allow the police to destroy documents 3 years after a conviction.
The confession of Patrick Molloy would have been destroyed. We would not have been able to do the scientific test. It would have been a disaster, and I sincerely hope that law never takes effect.
Tonight, the government said it was prepared to consider extending the period for which documents had to be kept in serious cases. But pressure for a full inquiry into the issues raised by the Bridgewater case seems set to continue. Jennifer Nadel, News at 10, Central London.
Police in Sussex are refusing to confirm or deny tonight that they're questioning the foster father of the murdered schoolgirl Billie-Jo Jenkins. Earlier, detectives announced they'd arrested a local man who they said was in his 30s. It's the third arrest since Billie-Jo was killed in the back garden of her home in Hastings. Our South of England correspondent Robert Hall reports.
The inquiry team were working late at Hastings tonight. The man detained at 9 this morning has faced detailed questioning. He'll be held in custody. Detectives have been following up a number of new leads since their evidence-gathering operation around Billie-Jo Jenkins' home over the weekend. Those heading the team would not comment on reports in some newspapers that the man now being held is 39-year-old Sean Jenkins, who became Billie-Jo's legal guardian in December. He found her battered body when he returned home with two of his natural daughters. Last week, he appeared at an emotional press conference.
Billie-Jo was loving and supportive to her four sisters. She was also buoyant, articulate, quick to learn, loud and fun-loving.
Mr. Jenkins has not returned home since the murder. The house remains under police guard. The family at a secret address this evening as rain lashes the flowers and cards which still arrive each day. Senior officers remain guarded about today's development, though I understand no charges are likely tonight. The man in custody can be held for up to 36 hours before an extension is applied for. We expect a further update tomorrow. Robert Hall, News at 10, Hastings.
In a few hours' time, China will officially bring the curtain down on the life of its former leader, Deng Xiaoping. 10,000 mourners will attend a memorial ceremony in the Great Hall of the People in Beijing. Today, many thousand more Chinese lined the streets as his body was driven to the city's crematorium. Our Asia correspondent Mark Austin reports from the Chinese capital.
Tonight in Beijing, the scene is set for tomorrow's formal memorial service for Deng Xiaoping, the end of 6 days of official mourning. But today was the chance for the people of this city to say their farewell to the man who changed China.
At a military hospital in Beijing, China's government leaders pay their last respects to Deng Xiaoping, one of the veterans of Chinese communism, but also the man who opened this once-closed Stalinist society to the world. His widow, two daughters, and a son crippled during Mao's Cultural Revolution led the mourners. In a glass coffin he was carried, in a solemn ceremony to begin his final journey to a cemetery where China's revolutionary heroes are traditionally laid to rest. Slowly down the avenue of eternal peace past the funeral cortege, this was the last chance for the ordinary people of China to bid farewell to the leader who maintained repressive rule, but whose economic reforms improved the living standards for millions. Thousands lining the route were bussed in from local factories, but clearly there are many who genuinely mourn his passing. Deng's family had asked for a low-key funeral, and his ashes will be scattered in the sea, possibly off Hong Kong, at the time of the handover to China later this year. Tonight in Beijing, the American Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, met President Jiang Zemin. It's a handshake Deng's chosen successor will see as international recognition of his leadership.
Many thought Deng's death would usher in a period of uncertainty in China, but tonight's meetings with Madeleine Albright are an attempt by Chinese leaders to present a face of stability and continuity to the outside world. Mark Austin, News at 10, Tiananmen Square, Beijing.
Three people were killed today in a motorway crash near Bristol as heavy rain and gale force winds swept southern England. Winds of up to 80 miles an hour are predicted tonight, with warnings of severe damage to buildings. Forecasters say it will be the worst period of sustained storms for 7 years. From Hastings, Tim Hewitt reports.
The south coast was preparing for the worst tonight, bracing itself for winds that it's feared could reach hurricane force at times. This was Hastings in East Sussex, already being subjected to ferocious gusts. Elsewhere, they were taking what precautions they could. On the Somerset coast, sandbags were being used to fortify amusement arcades and seafront shops. Weather forecasters had warned of a severe depression heading in from the Atlantic, bringing with it driving rain and gale force winds. The force of those gales was already being felt in Portsmouth. It made for heavy going for passenger ferries and hovercraft. And there were warnings of severe disruption to cross-channel services in the hours ahead. The weather made driving conditions treacherous. Three people were killed in a pile-up on the M5 near Bristol. Two of them were travelling in a car which burst into flames when it collided with a tanker. It set light to a van, killing the van driver. In London, commuters were battling with increasingly severe conditions, and the predictions are that there's more to come.
Well, we've certainly got more unsettled weather to come, at least for the foreseeable future. For the rest of February, it's a case of one depression coming in after another, rolling in off the Atlantic. Yes, more strong winds. Yes, more rain. we don't think it's going to be as strong as it was tonight.
Here in Hastings, it's now virtually impossible to remain upright in the worst of the gusts which are sweeping the front. It looks like being a long and very angry night, and fears are growing that the storms may inflict the worst damage seen for several years. Tim Ewart, News at 10, on the South Coast.
The government will confirm tomorrow that the London Underground will be privatised if the Conservatives win the next election. The Transport Secretary, Sir George Young, will tell the Commons that fare increases will be capped as they were with the British Rail sell-off. Labour described that tonight as a crackpot scheme. The police are to study video evidence of a mass brawl involving soccer players at Saturday's Division 2 match between Chesterfield and Plymouth. The incident resulted in four players being sent off, and the Football Association says it's also considering action. ITN's Ian Glover-James reports.
Minutes from the end of the game, a Chesterfield corner ended in a mass brawl in the goal mouth. Plymouth's goalkeeper Bruce Grobbelaar was floored as players ignored the referee's whistle and traded punches. Referee Richard Poulain advanced into a welter of angry counterclaims. Meanwhile, the dazed Grobbelaar, stunned by the clash, needed medical attention. There was only one ending, the red card, again and again. Four players sent off for this brawl, a fifth earlier, the biggest sending off in recent football. And after it all, the referee blamed it on today's high-pressure clashes.
I blew the whistle for the foul, and but then I don't think the players all heard it at the same time, and they carried on trying to kick the ball, and unfortunately things spilled over. The trouble now nowadays is there's so much money in this sport. There's a lot of tension, people's jobs are on the line, people's careers are on the line, etc.
Police and the Football Association are now studying what happened and may press charges. For the troubled Bruce Grobbelaar, some comfort. The referee said he was about the only one who didn't get involved. Ian Glover-James, News at 10.
Coming up next on News at 10 tonight, growing concern over the cloned sheep that could change the face of science. A feast of goals in tonight's Premiership match. And the royal row over Britannia.
We're going aboard the royal yacht in the Gulf where Prince Charles is on an official visit. But is Britannia such a national asset that the taxpayer should fund a replacement?
Five, six, Fisher ceiling composite, seven occlusal, eight absent. Upper left, one, two. Could you just open a little bit wider for me, please? Just a little bit more. I bought a Golf GTI the other day. It only cost $14,650. That's better. Thank you. Two, three, four occlusal.
Who came with me when I bought my new glasses?
Mr. Reynolds.
And who said they'll look completely ridiculous on me? Well, you should have, because it's true. At the car, we're going shopping. Stop!
They're gorgeous. It's you.
What do you think?
I think they're wrong. You see, you've got strong cheekbones.
I know.
So a curved frame would suit you better. These are more you. What do you think?
Perfect. Thank you, Janine. You've been wonderful.
I think you're wonderful too. Could I have your autograph? It's from a gran.
Dolland and Aitchison, where everyone gets star treatment.
I am the interest rate on the National Savings Guaranteed Income Bond, and I'm very high.
And I'm the interest rate on the Birmingham Midshires Guaranteed Income Bond Plus account, and actually I'm higher.
I thought I was the highest.
Not anymore. And I'm also available to anyone over the age of 50.
What? You have to wait till you're 60 to get me?
Fancy that.
The figures speak for themselves. The Birmingham Midshires Guaranteed Income Bond Plus account at 7.1% beats even national savings. For this limited offer, call free now.
There is no tougher test on your hands than working in the coldest and roughest of conditions. But through long experience, Arctic fishermen have learnt that Neutrogena can look after their hands. Neutrogena Hand Cream is clinically proven to give immediate relief. And it can also work for you. Neutrogena. Hard-working hand cream for hard-working hands.
Itchy, flaky scalp, relieved by T-Gel. Treat your scalp without mistreating your hair.
Well,
Well, here we are in Paris to tell you about the latest cuts BT are making to the cost of international calls. What are you supposed to be?
A mime.
Okay, mime this. Calls to France and Germany have been cut by at least 10%. A five-minute weekend call drops from £1.30 to just £1.17, or as little as 88p if you're with BT's Friends and Family and Premier Line. Actually, I thought you were rather good, you know.
Thanks.
Particularly liked your 88p. Very moving.
Call 0800 003 800 to see how much you could save. He's discriminated against because of his age. They're discriminated against because they're on a budget. For an open-minded view of car insurance, call Swinton on 0800 600 700.
Welcome back. Scientists in Edinburgh were today defending their decision to produce the world's first clone of an adult animal. The sheep called Dolly is an exact genetic copy of another from which a single cell was extracted. There's been some concern because the breakthrough means it may one day be possible to make clones of humans. Our science editor Lawrence McGinty reports.
Dolly is unique. The first ever sheep, indeed the first ever mammal to be born a clone of her mother. She's the result not of the normal mixing of genes from mother and father, but from the copying of genes from only one parent. She's genetically identical to her mother.
What we've been able to do for the first time in this experiment is to take a cell from an adult animal and use it to produce what is really a genetically identical twin to that animal.
The scientists took a cell from the udder of an adult sheep and grew it in the laboratory. An unfertilized egg was taken from another sheep. The nucleus of that egg, which contains all the genetic material, was removed. The egg was then implanted with the donor cell. This grew using the same genetic instructions as the donor sheep, making an exact copy of itself. The embryo was implanted in a surrogate mother, who eventually gave birth naturally to a clone. These experiments, licensed by the Home Office, could lead to a way of mass-producing sheep by cloning, all genetically engineered, to make drugs in their milk. Scientists say the breakthrough could also provide them with new tools for research on aging and cancer. But cloning humans, they say, will be illegal and pointless.
Sometimes I would like to be cloned because I've got so much work to do. It'd be nice to have two of me. But that's ridiculous. I mean, you can't clone an individual because an individual is a product of their environment as well as their genes.
Tonight, there were calls for a moratorium on further animal cloning until the ethical implications for humans are more widely debated. In any case, it will be years before sheep experiments can be transferred to humans. Lawrence McGinty, News at 10.
The family of a Palestinian gunman who opened fire on tourists at the Empire State Building say he had no connection with terrorist groups. One person was killed and six were wounded in the attack by 69-year-old Ali Abu Kamal. After the attack, he turned his gun on himself. The political big guns turned out in World South today to join the campaign for Thursday's by-election. Health issues dominated events, though for Defence Secretary Michael Portillo, not everything went according to plan. Here's our political editor, Michael Brunson.
Labour really want to win World South. They believe it'll knock Tory morale, just as it ought to be picking up ahead of the general election. So, with his wife, Tony Blair was back for a third campaign visit, making health the issue by touring the big regional hospital, actually just outside the constituency, which most voters in this by-election use.
Do you think it's a pushover for you?
Of course not. No, we are never complacent. We work for every single vote and for every piece of trust, and we never stop doing that.
Demonstrators wanting to save Barts Hospital in London muscled in on the by-election campaigning as the Liberal Democrats again promised more NHS money than any other party.
Labour Party are not even promising as much as the Conservatives, which is incredible. What we're saying is we need to find, and we will find, an extra £550 million, and we've said how we're going to pay for that.
With Michael Portillo campaigning at a local golf club, health became an issue, with an anti-smoking protester bundled out of the clubhouse he'd managed to invade. The protester not handled too gently outside either by the outraged golfers. But as the defence secretary slipped out of the back door and eventually across the course, the Conservatives' main problem remained how to get even their core vote out so close to a general election. I think this is the first by-election, seriously, I've ever covered, where visiting people like you are not prepared to come in and say, yeah, 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 we're going to win.
I say, yeah, 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 we're going to campaign to the last moment. And in the last few weeks, the people of Wirral South have seen Labour on this hook of their hostility to the grammar schools, and choice and diversity in education matters a lot to the people of Wirral South and to all the people of Britain.
So, stand by to hear on Friday morning, Labour no doubt hailing a great victory, the Liberal Democrats taking heart, whatever the result, and the Tories pointing to those occasions when by-election defeats close to a general election in the past have not noticeably harmed their fortunes. Michael Brunson, News at 10, in the Wirral South constituency.
There are 12 candidates in the Wirral South by-election. These are their names and the parties they represent. Members of the Halifax Building Society voted overwhelmingly today to make it a bank. Its more than 8 million customers will now receive free shares worth an average of about £1,300. 97% of savers and borrowers voted in favour. The Princess of Wales is to sue the Express on Sunday newspaper over claims that she was about to profit from a charity auction of her evening dresses. The Princess says all the money will go to charities for AIDS and cancer. And the funeral of a soldier murdered by the IRA took place today on what would have been his 24th birthday. Lance Bombardier Stephen Resterick was shot dead by a sniper at a checkpoint in South Armagh. The Royal Yacht Britannia sailed majestically into the port of Bahrain today for an official visit by Prince Charles. The yacht's on its final tour before it's retired from service later this year. Financing a replacement has caused a major political row, with supporters insisting it's a valuable business asset. But what is it that makes Britannia so special? ITN's royal correspondent Nicholas Owen has been given exclusive access to film behind the scenes during this, her last tour. This is his special report.
The last few days, Britannia, marine band playing, has sailed the Gulf, her proud crew nursing the 44-year-old vessel gingerly into three different ports, aiming to do business for Britain with the locals in Kuwait, Bahrain and Qatar. Originally, the royal family monopolised Britannia, the ship cosseted for long seaborne state visits, private holidays, even honeymoons. The staterooms for royal use today are plush, but comfortable rather than eye-catchingly opulent. But as the museum piece of an engine room proved when we were shown round the Britannia, this is an old-fashioned ship, costing £10 million annually to run, much more than she cost to build. Supporters say gleam and glitter's part of an asset which this last voyage will spend 17 days hosting receptions, conferences, lunches and dinners to encourage foreign deal-making. Critics doubt whether the royal yacht is such a national asset that the taxpayer should be called upon to fund a £60 million replacement. They argue that business people the world over are too hard-headed to be impressed by such surroundings, however splendid. Lance Rowell, an exporter from Chepstow, actually sells tents to Arabs, together with more grand structures like huge marquees. He had dinner in the home of one of his Kuwaiti business contacts, a couple of whom he'd been told he could take to an evening reception aboard the yacht.
Hamoud, have you made arrangements for getting to Britannia on Saturday?
Yes. About 200 attended the reception, many people like Mr. Rowell entertaining their Arab associates. A royal presence supported the business of the evening. So for tent exporter Lance Rowell, did it work?
Britannia was not there to impress me, it was there to impress my guests, and it did. And I think we've cemented a relationship which I think will lead to business.
So will deals result? Will more money come to Britain as a result?
My fingers are crossed, but I certainly am expecting so.
Another day in the Gulf for the yacht and for her crew. More functions aboard to prepare for. Below, galley chefs work on food a top restaurant would be happy with, bought of course with taxpayers' money, once for royal consumption, now mostly for business people. The skipper is convinced that the royal yacht continues to be a worthwhile deployment of government funds.
It's always very difficult to be able to tie down with Britannia precise quantification of a particular trade deal or a particular contract or whatever it may be. But there's no doubt about it that the sense that Britannia brings to those discussions and the colour that she adds to it, drawing the people to her, and the lovely events that we stage manage on board for their benefit are all very much part of the success.
The arguments continue, whether British royalty and the Britannia are absolutely vital to impress many foreigners, though some claim the Britannia effect is worth at least £30 million a year. Skeptics think if a replacement's needed once the yacht sails into retirement in November, why not encourage private financiers to ensure Britannia continues to rule the waves? Nicholas Owen, News at 10, in the Gulf.
The governing body of world soccer today ruled out any joint bid by England and Germany to host the 2006 World Cup finals. A FIFA spokesman said the proposal from Germany would not be approved. England officials also gave it a lukewarm reaction. And on the field of play, there was a feast of goals in tonight's premiership game between London rivals West Ham and Tottenham Hotspur. Teddy Sheringham used his head to open the scoring. West Ham's Julian Dix equalised in similar fashion. A minute later, the Hammers took the lead with another header, this time from Paul Kitson. A cheeky lob from Darren Anderton pulled it back for Spurs. Then John Houston scored on his home debut to make it 3-2. But a superb side-footed shot from David Howells levelled the score again for Spurs. The game was finally decided by a penalty, the second of the night for Julian Dix. The final score, 4-3. And the main headlines again. A former detective has denied he fabricated evidence of the Carl Bridgewater murder case. Retired Detective Constable Graham Leake had been named in court as one of the officers who faked a confession. And gale force winds are sweeping southern Britain tonight. Forecasters say it could be the stormiest night for a decade. And finally, pop's top people gathered for the Brit Awards tonight, and stars, old and new, were given something to sing about. Some fans, though, may have been a little confused, as Helen Wright reports.
Arriving in the kind of limousine that befits Brit Award nominees, and to the clamour of screaming fans, the feisty five breezed through Earl's Court security with all the confidence of the Spice Girls. It was only later someone realised they were fakes. The real queens of Britpop took the honours tonight, this their first release winning Best Single. They also won the Best Video category. George Michael crowned a triumphant comeback by taking the Best Male Artist. Other winners at tonight's ceremony, Gabrielle voted Best Female Artist, and the Manic Street Preachers, who beat the Spice Girls to take Best Band. And the But the night belonged to the Bee Gees. This number one in 1967 was the start of an enduring international career. 30 years on, their new single is at number five in the charts, evidence of a talent that survived a notoriously fickle industry, and tonight won them the Brits' Outstanding Contribution to Music Award. Helen Wright, News at 10.
That's News at 10 tonight. Good night.
Now, this evening saw severe gales blowing across southern parts of England and Wales. Already the worst of those have moved out into the North Sea, taking the heaviest of the rain with them, but leaving a fair number of showers behind for much of the country, and also strong winds, in fact, still blowing to gale force in the west. Those winds will last through tomorrow as well. In fact, the worst of the weather here, really. Most of tomorrow's rain across the west country and Wales, and turning into wintry showers here further north. For the rest of Scotland, though, a better day on the whole. Some brightness here, together with eastern counties of England, and the high here, 9 Celsius. That's a relatively mild 48 in terms of Fahrenheit. Of course, it's always going to feel chillier here in the brunt of the winds in amongst the rain. A brief respite is in store for the middle of the week, though. We'll see a high pressure controlling our weather. Afraid it won't last long, this Atlantic system here already approaching from the west. So do make the most of Wednesday's weather then, because I'm afraid that's about as good as it's going to get. Some brightness for many of us, despite one or two wintry showers further north. After a promising start on Thursday, we'll see more gales and more rain entering from the northwest, sweeping across the country on Friday. That's it from me. Good night.
Power Gen. Generating electricity whatever the weather.